Well, Deacon John Wilson here, Education Enrichment Director for West Angeles Church. We're here December 1st. And a lot of you, you know, I've gotten some texts and emails, and I see in the social media that everybody thinks that their computer is broken because they can't find the FAFSA. But as I stated all along, the government said it would be available in December. They did not say what day. So it is clearly not available today. I went to the FAFSA Facebook site. Everybody's whining about it, but I saw people a month ago on there who were experts saying it's going to drop December 1st, but I couldn't find any evidence of it. So anyway, a lot of you are encountering that today. And it's not your fault, I mean, but it's just how there's a lot of disinformation out there. This is what you get when you go to FAFSA.gov, by the way. You get a page that says, form is coming in December. Learn about the 24-25. By the way, some of you will think that this is your FAFSA form, the 23-24 FAFSA, but it is not your FAFSA form. A lot of people are going to make that mistake, but if you read over here, it says applies to college for 7/21/23 to 6/3/24. It doesn't say fall of 24 on there. So I know a lot of people are going to start their FAFSAs early and it'll be the wrong year. Oh, if you're starting it, please stop. The form is not available yet. This is going to cause a lot of confusion, I can already tell. When you click learn about it, and you should do that, you get more information. It says, what can you do now? You know, it says basically set up your username and password. And I covered that in a separate video. I'll include the video down below in the description. But I just wanted to be sure we knew that the FAFSA did not drop today. Now, it will eventually drop, and you should start thinking about, you know, there's some things you should think about. So now I'm going to give you an overview of the FAFSA form. Or I should have said, go through the key points of the FAFSA process. It's a good time to do that again. So let's do that. FAFSA stands for Free Application for Federal Student Aid. The FAFSA for 24-25 is based on the 22 federal tax return. And this year, as you'll see me hint at a little later on the next video, I'll go into detail. They're setting up the FAFSA where you have to complete your tax return, parents. So if you've not filed your 22 taxes yet, got to get those filed. They will not give financial aid without that happening this year. So they're not going to do verification anymore. So the way the new regulations are written for the new FAFSA, I think you got to do your taxes. If that alarms you, you just got to get that together now. And any extensions or, I'm sorry, any corrections you want to file, you got to get those filed because it can't have a correction on it either. So I hope that didn't shock people. Anyway, the first date for the 24-25 FAFSA, and I have it here, December? Well, it wasn't today, you know, so it could be tomorrow, it could be the next day, but they never said a date. So that's why I have question marks on mine here. We recommend that all FAFSAs be ready for filing January 1st to 15th. That's me assuming it could be December 31st in the worst case. There may be an announcement by the government about this FAFSA, because I heard from a reliable source they're having some difficulties with that form. I fully expect when we get it, there may be some quirks still in it. But this is why you might want to bring your FAFSA to us to do. We ask for a small donation, but it's well worth it if you've never filed one before. And we're going to talk about that in our meeting on Sunday. But I'll include another video down below about last week's meeting that will help you with that. So I'll include the video that tells you how to set up a username and password. And then our video from last week's session where we talked about the FAFSA for a good part of that session. Okay? Other facts, the colleges don't require a tax return anymore. Some of you parents remember, if this is your first child for college, that when you went to college, they required the tax return. Not anymore. They're going to want to transfer it from your tax return automatically within the FAFSA. The FAFSA can look at that data and pull it over. However, if you make less than $55,000, the school may require a tax transcript from you. I don't think they're going to do that much longer because the data for the taxes are going to be in there. But nevertheless, this year, I think you should order a transcript. I don't know what to expect if colleges have not kept up in their training. Some selective private schools also require a document called the CSS profile, which is requesting information above and beyond the FAFSA. That's not for every school. It's certain schools. I'll do a separate video on the CS profile. I usually do that right about this time of year anyway, but it's only for certain schools. How about some of the local schools that are notable? USC requires the CSS profile. Chapman College requires the CSS profile. Let's see, there's others too. I think the Claremont Colleges all require it, or two of them require it, but it's commonly required from private schools. There are some selective state colleges that require it as well. If you go to their website, they'll tell you whether they require it. Or get a hold of me, I'll show you how to look it up, or I know myself. Okay? The profile may require information on the divorced or separated parent also. The FAFSA should only require the information on the custodial parent. Now, this, I think, is going to be a questionable for the new FAFSA. Used to be one parent, and you take the parent that they're living with. There's joint custody, the one that has the lower income. But I think that's changing now. So I'll talk about that in the next video or the one after. I'll go into more detail because I got to do a video on the stuff happening on the campuses too. But I'm going to leave this the way it is for now. The profile does require it. The FAFSA does not currently, but the new form may have something to say to that. It has a lot of definitions of separated versus divorced. And I have here divorced or separated. So we'll get into that in a future video. The FAFSA is not, I think I will cover that a little in this video, actually. The FAFSA is not wholly user-friendly. It's highly likely that you'll make a mistake if it's your first time. Using a mistake is not critical, but sometimes it is. By the way, while my mind is on it, don't let your youth file their FAFSA. It's not a good idea, parents. They're not paying for college. You are. You file the FAFSA acting like you're them, okay? That's what I do when I file it for them. Here's what you'll need to file the FAFSA. FAFSA username and password. Remember that video below. I'll tell you how to do that. Youth and parent. The federal tax return for 2022. Not because you're sending it to them, but some of the things needed on the form are, in fact, definitely in this new FAFSA, it only takes information that's on the tax return. That's in case you can't retrieve the data for whatever reason. But the reason cannot be that you didn't file. Just because you filled it out at home and you're looking at it does not mean you filed. So you really need to get your 2022 return done. Okay. Excuse me, you go to FAFSA.gov. Mistakes on the FAFSA are usually in the follow-up phase when colleges ask questions and they make you nervous and you think you need to make a change to your FAFSA. I've seen some huge mistakes this way. Of course, they get suspicious when the FAFSA is being changed a lot. Please, no youth should file their own FAFSA, as I said. And maybe they never should file. I say first-year student. Some students should never really file that. Let them concentrate on school. Do not have a commercial service or a financial manager file the FAFSA. It's going to cost you $1,000, $2,000. They'll have you convinced you have to do it, and you don't. We'll do it for you for around $50. Some of you, a lot of you, won't be charged at all if your incomes are below the income rate I'll tell you about in a minute, if it's at the Pell Grant level, okay? If you have that kind of need. And it's not too hard to get under that. You'll see in a minute. Remember, the FAFSA is need-based, not academic, artistic, or athletic. It's none of those things, okay? It's not athletic, artistic, or academic. Grades are more important than ever with this new system, as you're going to see in a minute. These are the new things on this FAFSA. And man, grades are really important for getting merit awards that don't come under the FAFSA. The form is simplified down to 36 questions from 108. Now, if this is your first time, this doesn't mean anything to you. You'll just see the FAFSA the way it is when it drops. But for those of you who have done FAFSAs before, this is going to be, quote, simpler. And if you have done it for a child that's already in college, it's supposedly much simpler than the other one. The form is more dependent on a completed 22 return than ever. I won't repeat again what I said about that. In the event of divorce or separation, the parent who contributes the most financially is the custodial parent, and their information is the information provided. Now, I got to be careful here. I probably shouldn't have said or separated. We'll talk about that in a minute. Here it is. Separations must be legal separated. So if you're separated, you know, from your spouse and you're the custodial parent, and you don't want that other parent considered, I'm just telling you the changes, man. You got to get a legal separation. And I don't know in the state of California how easy it is. I'm not a lawyer. It may be as simple as just writing a letter to each other. One writes it to the other that you've agreed to that. And maybe both sign it. I don't know. But you need to check with a lawyer. I'll have to find out on my own, too, how difficult or how hard that is. But they have to be legal. I guess this year I won't immediately follow that when I'm filing. But I tell you, next year I'm going to sure have to do it. Both incomes will be needed if there's not a legal separation. See, they got kind of tired of people being separated in the same house still. And so that caused a lot of confusion. And this might disturb a lot of people, but there's a provision also that if you're living with someone in your house, that both incomes have to be considered. And on our program, we follow the law. So, right. Okay. More on that when I do that expanded version later. Increased aid eligibility for single parents. That's pretty cool. And also for foster kids. So if you're a single parent, you'll get more financial aid. You have a better chance of getting federal aid. I mean, if your income is real high, you won't anyway. You won't get need-based aid. But if you're a single parent, and you'll see the table in a minute, it's really easy to get a Pell Grant. There's decreased aid, therefore, for middle-class families above $50,000 for dependents, maybe $55,000, I'll show in a minute. Families of two or more students in college are going to get decreased aid. I put yikes because this is why the middle class stays upset with the government. Doesn't matter what party you're in either. You're in the middle class. There's a lot of angry people out there in the middle class. My Lord, you make too much to get federal aid or to get need-based aid from some of these schools, maybe not all of them. You know, you make too much to get that, but you don't make enough to pay for it. Now you have this. If you have a child in college, all things being equal, you could pay less. But that's going to depend on the private colleges. See, if you look at that last bullet, it's going to depend on whether the private colleges will follow this stuff. Because they're private colleges. They don't have to follow it. But I bet you a lot of them will. I bet a lot of them will follow it. Because of this equity stuff, they might want to follow it, think it's going to help their Black students more. But if you have a Black family that's middle class, you're not happy with this. But sometimes people in the financial aid policy business feel that they help poor people, they're going to help a lot of Black people, which is condescending. Black people have a diverse set of income situations in their homes, Black and brown for that matter. Let's take a look at this poverty level stuff. This might be helpful to you. All right. 175%, 225% of the poverty level are new income levels for the determination of the maximum Pell Grant. Now, no one knows how this will affect private colleges. Nobody knows. They created a new index called the SAI, but who knows? I bet they don't know how they're going to read it right now. I don't know. I wish they'd do things like this in stages and announce this for next year now, but it's coming now. 175% of the poverty income, 225% of property income. There's the table. Get this out of the way here. Let me turn off my video. Sorry. All right. You can see. Let's see if I can. 175% of poverty income is two parents. If you have one child, $25,515 is your maximum Pell Grant level. And as you go away from 25,515 family size of one, it goes down. I don't know how quick. Nobody knows that. I don't know. Family size two is 34,000, et cetera, when you have two parents. Look down at level at number at family size four. At a family size of four, you can get a maximum Pell Grant at $52,500. Two parents, two students. That's as high, that's much higher than it is now. It's considerably higher. Over on the single parent side over here, the blue arrow, it's 225% of poverty income there. There, see, that's what I mean, that single parents get an advantage in financial aid. The Pell Grant would be maximum up to 32,000 with one, well, family size of one doesn't make sense, but two, it's 44,370. You have yourself, parent, and your student, and you make income of 40,000, you get a maximum Pell Grant. Okay. Again, you might want to pause the screen and look at it and find yourself on the chart to see if you'll get any federal aid. Most people on my program will not get federal aid. Your families just aren't large enough to get that, nor, and your income is too high. But a family of four and a single parent, it's kind of remarkable that at $67,500 or less, you could receive a maximum Pell Grant. That's unbelievable, but it's true. Okay, but you have to have three children, and that's where it gets tricky. Now, I've had families with a single parent and six kids, and you know, 90,000 Pell Grant is nice. All right, I hope that you got something out of that. Hope that you got something out of that presentation and that you'll get your FAFSA together. And remember, down below, get your username and password. Be ready. Let's get ready, okay? And I also included the instructions for getting your username and password down below as well. You can always email me, holythinkers@gmail.com, holythinkers@gmail.com. And if you like the information I presented in this video, please like and subscribe, especially if you're currently a class of 2024 parent in my program. You need to subscribe and need to come back and look at this video channel periodically. You can just Google the channel, Wes Anders Education Enrichment, or you can reach it through the website, okay? The website, upper right corner, you can click on the YouTube symbol and you come right to our YouTube channel. God bless you all. Bye-bye now.